BAM is a communications agency that believes stories move the world. We move stories forward for technology-driven brands that challenge, change, and create entire industries. Today on Dear BAMf, we're talking with Nicole Canulla, Head of Marketing and Communications at Dust Identity. Nicole leads Dust Marketing Strategy, utilizing her extensive experience in sales enablement, content creation, media relations, corporate communications, and investor relations. Nicole is also the founder of Canulla Communications, where she provides strategic communications counsel to her clients. Let's dive in.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Dear BAMf, the podcast for PR and marketing pros such as yourself. Nicole, thank you for being here today. We're excited to have you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be on, to be included in your podcast.
Great. Let's get into our first question here. And as we mentioned, you've got, you're in the CMO role and the startup space. So a lot of these are going to be perfect. Let's hear the first one. Dear BAMf, I come from a pretty fast paced startup world, and now I'm head of comms at a startup that is just, well, more cautious when it comes to making a stand or dealing with the crisis. In particular, my CEO seems to drag his feet when there is an urgent need to say something, whether it be about leaked data of our clients or racism in America, both major issues that happened in the last 6 months here. How can I convince our CEO to act more quickly? Suggestions. Nicole.
Great. Well, Beck, so this is a really timely question, obviously. I think that there's a couple different things we can focus on here. And it's not really clear where what the question asker is looking for, whether it's, is this internally facing or is it externally? So I think it makes sense. Maybe we can talk about both.
Let's do it. Yes. Because we don't have the full context here. So yeah, let's get into it.
Yeah. So I'd say, you know, from an internal perspective, I would encourage the individual to round up some other C-level executives or other parts of the management team to help be kind of a champion of the importance of addressing these types of crises internally. And because maybe he's not personally comfortable with sharing his perspective, perhaps if it's related to racism in America, and he wants to be overly cautious depending on who their clients are, it still needs to be addressed. And I think that it can be far more detrimental not to communicate to employees on topics, whether it's what's happening with leaked data of their clients or something more sensitive around diversity and racism. So I think it has to be addressed. And if you can get some other key stakeholders within your own organization to sit down and all collectively discuss what is the right approach to address this internally, then you may be able to get him on board, or him or her. Mm-hmm. So I would encourage, maybe that would be a good first step, if again, this is internally. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yes. Now, what about on the external front? Sounds like this person is talking about leaked data. So I'm sure that's coming out perhaps for this person.
So one thing, and actually this goes to internally as well, but you think about, what are your own company values? I would imagine they stand for, whether it's trust and openness or transparency or diversity, they probably have some values that they preach as a company, and they should practice what they preach. So if it's whatever, maybe that's, again, that value is, then they should stand by it. So if they should be open and candid about this sort of information. So we think about externally, there's a couple different ways you could look at it there too, right? Is this, should we jump on an opportunity to pitch media and have our voice be heard when it comes to racism in America? And I'd be cautious around those type of areas, because I think it depends on who you are as a company. It doesn't really make sense for your CEO to be out there speaking, and maybe it doesn't. And I think that is fair pushback from a CEO if that's the case. But in a case of getting in touch with your clients, or making a statement or responding to media about something along the lines of leaked data, I think there's no question, again, that you have to communicate. And again, it'll be more detrimental if you don't. So I would, again, maybe gather up some other key stakeholders in your organization, whether that's the sales team, the business development team, some of the folks who are on the ground and running the accounts and speaking to the clients and the customers, to help communicate how detrimental this could be if we don't get out there and share the right information that needs to be shared.
Mm-hmm. The thing too with this is the news cycle, social media, everything, the internet is so quick these days. And how many examples could we give? I'm thinking of a couple in my mind that an internal memo, a Slack message sent, becomes leaked and is suddenly now available and posted on a Medium post or posted on social media, and it becomes something. So there's just no, I don't think you can hide really anything.
I think that's a great point. And I think along those lines, right? So if it's an internal memo that you want to share internally, but you're not sure if it could potentially be leaked, then have an all-hands staff meeting, something where you can communicate to your employees and still be transparent from an internal perspective. I think that raises a good point in how you want to communicate.
So yeah, I think for this writer, just on the fact of, how can I convince our CEO to act more quickly? It's just that there's no way you cannot act quickly, given the churn of what is now available to basically any consumer, any person, any employee to figure out and find out. And then to your point, Nicole, yeah, there's definitely an internal and an external component to it too. Your internal people, we don't know how big of a company this person's at, but your internal comms is even more monumental typically about this stuff, because they even are up front and center with a lot of what's happening. And so being on top of that and communicating with them is really important.
For sure. Yep, I completely agree.
Okay, well, let's get into our next question. Dear BAMf, I'm trying to get an additional budget from my CMO. I'm the head of comms for context at a public tech company. The problem I'm dealing with is the CMO is asking for some ridiculous KPIs for a thought leadership campaign, one I know wouldn't be feasible for any agency to commit to, but I get where she is coming from. We have a tough CEO who isn't too educated on what is actually feasible. What are your suggestions for getting this budget approved, considering I'm a few layers down from who will sign off on this? We have the new CEO's blessing because the scope entails a big thought leadership campaign from him.
Yeah, there's a lot in here, and I don't envy this person. It's tough, right? You've got the issue of expectation setting and budget approval, so neither are easy feats. So I think first we could think about the expectation setting, and I would encourage this person to first look at, why are you doing this campaign? And maybe they have, but I think it's important to step back and say, what is the bigger picture of the company's goals? What are the KPIs for all of marketing? What are the KPIs for the sales team? And how does this thought leadership campaign actually align with those? And then when you're looking at success, what defines success? Is that the number of placements or backlinks to your website? I think that there's a lot to really explore. And I'm hoping that I'd encourage them to do that, to really step back and say, let's make sure that this bigger goal, that what we're supposed to achieve, it makes sense. It aligns with the company's bigger mission. So I think that I would certainly start there. And then also on expectation setting, there's a lot of room for education. I mean, it's not the CEO's job to entirely understand or even the CMO's job. They may not have background in communications and PR, and they may not completely understand the current media landscape. And they need to look at, you know, how are these outlets that would define success, whether they're business outlets or they're tech outlets, how are those outlets shifting in coverage areas? Is it COVID impacted? How is the staff? I know there's been a lot of downsizing at a lot of these tech publications. So I think that there's room to educate both the CMO and CEO on, this is what the landscape looks like, and this is what's possible given that. I think that's a good kind of starting place. And if you can come with prepared data to show what that landscape looks like, I think that could be beneficial for setting expectations. Then on the second step of kind of thinking about the budget approval, I would encourage getting a few high-level proposals from various agencies and not wasting their time and having them necessarily fill out huge RFPs, but just saying, you know, this is what our CEO is asking for, and I need to show him that this is the cost of the level of service in order to get these sort of results. And if that's what you come back with to the CMO and CEO, the proposals will speak for themselves. This is the going rate, and this is what we have to commit to.
Exactly.
And along those lines too, this is a little bit outside of it, but I'd be really transparent with whatever agency you decide to work with, what the kind of internal pressures are that you're facing, just so that you guys can really work as partners and attack this, you know, these KPIs and reach these goals together. I think that you want to make sure that they know kind of the pressure you're under without scaring them off, of course, but just saying like, how can we do this together so they know what they're up against?
I love the recommendation here of have some other agencies, third parties validate, right? So instead of you just coming back as the spokesperson, especially as this person saying they're a couple layers down, saying, that's just not feasible. I don't know what you're talking about. You come with data. You say, you know, spoke with 5 other agencies, all highly reputable. When I mentioned that these were the KPIs, this is what they came back with. And consensus is, this isn't going to work. Or consensus is, we see this a lot, that's not going to work for this budget. That's not going to, you need to triple it or whatever it is. So data and third-party information helps so much. And then to your point too, how does this all tie up to the overall goals of the company and how does this trickle into it is so important. I love the recommendation on talk to other agencies. Also with being really candid with them and saying, hey, you know what? I'm getting this information from other people. I'm not in an RFP process. I'm not asking for a deck, but what is your response to these items? Something like that. That'll save them time. They will make them happy. And then they can give you a really honest answer. Because also they haven't spent 20 plus hours preparing some deck for you. That isn't going anywhere.
Yeah, no sense in wasting anyone's time. And I think this very early, you know, discussion, both with the CEO, the agencies, and getting everybody on the same page and making sure that you're all working towards a reasonable, sure, it can be aggressive, but a reasonable, aggressive, and a goal that makes sense and actually moves whatever needle it is, whether it's brand awareness or traffic to the website driven through backlinks and coverage in specific areas, you know, whatever that is, it's getting on the same page early on so that you're not just getting coverage to get coverage.
Mm-hmm. I like that. Next question we have. Dear BAMf, now that we're all working from home, I'm rethinking our internal comm strategy. I work at a company with 500 employees, and in early Q1, we got feedback that employees didn't feel communication was as frequent as it should be. How do you assess frequency and pace of internal comms for a company at our size? Ooh, this is a good one.
It is. And it ties a little bit back to what we were talking about in our earlier discussion about the importance of internal communications. And obviously, as the sounds of it, that employees here are not happy with the current level of communication. And I think it also ties back to what we were just talking about in terms of data as well. Let's get the data from the employees. Maybe the first step here is doing some sort of internal survey and getting feedback and understanding what do the employees want, like get a pulse on how often do they want communication, in what mediums do they want communication, and what types of information do they want? Is it a simple touch base because everyone's feeling, you know, this sense of kind of remoteness and they want to feel connected again? Or are they worried about perhaps the direction and the company's health during COVID right now? But there's a lot of things and reasoning behind why employees are kind of yearning for more communication. So I would say any type of internal kind of survey to gather and aggregate the feedback from them, then you can work to meet their expectations.
Mm-hmm.
I'd also say too, you know, things to think about. I work in a much smaller company and we've instituted what has been really great, these biweekly all hands meetings to serve that purpose of informing that everyone, making sure we're on the same page of what are our business goals and the health of the company, and to make everyone feel connected when we're in these different locations. And some people have gone back to maybe their parents' houses in different states. So it's bringing everybody together in this regular cadence, but maybe that's not appropriate for a 500 person company, but then what else could be done? Maybe again, if you can get the pulse of what people are looking for, perhaps they just want to hear from their team leaders and they want to have regularly like regional or department meetings. And my inclination would be probably some sort of mix would be best, where they get some type of communication from that top C level, but then maybe some sort of regular touch bases with their team leaders or something more personal where they're in a forum where they can ask questions or express things that might not be working well for them or challenges they're having.
There's definitely, and we don't know here, with the type of communication. Obviously, we're talking about internal comms, but there's a big difference to what you're alluding to of, okay, is that open forum, free ball questions? Is that email updates? Is that status update? Is that a video from the CEO? You know, how exactly does that look like beyond the frequency? Like, how exactly does that look like? So lots to unpack here. The survey is great. The only thing with surveys, I will say in caution, probably this person knows this too, is that often, not all the time, but often you'll get a swath of all types. Some will want this, some will not want it all. So you're not going to satisfy 100% of the people. You're just not. And you have 500 employees. Absolutely, you will not. Way easier when it's 10 people. So just keeping that in mind of knowing, okay, some people now on the contrary will complain there's too much communication. That is going to happen. That is absolutely going to happen. Okay. Well, if you're okay with that complaint instead of the other complaint of too less communication, I'd fall on the sword of, hey, if you're getting complaints about there's just too damn much communication, great. What a great complaint.
Yeah, right.
Much rather have that than less.
Yeah, I completely agree. And that you bring up a great point, right? 500 people, there's going to be a lot of different opinions on how they want to consume those updates. And maybe that's something that is built into their communication, internal communication strategy, right? Maybe it's they have optional recordings of the CEO every 2 weeks if they choose to listen to them, but they're not mandatory. There could be something to work for different audiences. But again, going back to that idea of getting the data from the employees and knowing what they want, at least you can report back and say, well, maybe you're hearing from us too much, but 72% of your colleagues actually want to hear from us this much. So there's at least some substance, yeah, to say, well, we're doing it because the majority or a portion feel it's important and we want to make sure to satisfy the needs of everyone in some form.
Yes. Last question here, Nicole, that we have. It's a big one. Dear BAMf, so much of our content that we put out on social media, our newsletter, and our blog is so self-serving. I'm now the head of comms at a growing health tech startup, and I want to be able to leverage our own content to impress potential reporters. Right now, I don't feel too comfortable doing that because there really aren't any stories to point to from the great successes we've had with doctors and patients whom we serve. Pushback from our CMO and founder has previously been, oh, there's a lot of HIPAA issues around sharing anything that our patients are doctors related. But I feel that's just an excuse. How can I convince them that securing press, which is what I've been tasked with, is going to need more stories and not just highlights of our funding dollars and a product tweak?
Well, this is perfect for you. Yeah. This is.
There's a lot in here, but first I applaud this person for recognizing that they can't be self-serving with all of their content. I don't think that's going to work for media, and I don't think that's going to work for prospects and customers either. So I think that's shifting that approach across the board is a great direction to go in. I think, you know, a couple things come to mind in pushing back from that CMO's and founder's pushback is, again, do the research and equip yourself with the facts, right? Do a media audit. And it doesn't have to be something formal, but where do they expect to get coverage and, you know, by what writers or what sections? And then show them the types of stories that are being written. And that might help reset expectations. If they want a story on a product tweak, you know, they want it in the Wall Street Journal, but you show them that this section of the Wall Street Journal in the last 2 years hasn't covered product news, I think, again, the data speaks for itself. And I think that starting with the education again is a really good first step. And then along those lines as well is talking directly to reporters. So doing a little mini reporter survey where you pick up the phone and call them. And I've had great success with this before. I think as long as you have some sort of established relationship with a journalist and it's not a cold call, and I've read some of or listened to some of your recent AMA webinars, as well as a couple of the journalist interviews in One Pitch, and they're reiterating those same things, right? They may not want a cold call, but they want to hear from the sources that they already know and the people they already know. So if you have some sort of relationship, then go to them and they'll appreciate the time that you're committing to saying, what are you interested in? What do you want to write in or write about? What are the topics that you're hearing, and getting their feedback so you can help shape the content and the angles to really meet the needs directly of the reporter. And I've had success again where you get their feedback and then you go to them and say, look, now I've given you the story that you were looking for. And they really appreciate that and want to run with it.
So true with this, like, do your research, come to the table. What's it going to take? This is so imperative for educating folks who have this lofty goal, right? Hey, rightfully so, audacious of like, I want to be on the cover of this. I want the full feature in that, all that stuff. Yes, wonderful, feasible. But here is how it is feasible. That is so important. What is it going to take? Again, it goes back to like the thing we were just talking about, budget. Oh, that's feasible. Those KPIs, sure. And it totally may not be. There might be just something so audacious it's not. But what is feasible? But then what is it going to take if now you've been tasked with these goals of like, well, I want to get into all these different things, all these different media publications. So get your journalists to tell you what's up. Point to the relevant stories. Look at competitor coverage too. Did they use all their patients? How did they do that if that was not HIPAA compliant or not? So this person, I think, needs to do a lot more research to come to the table to educate.
I agree. And that point, I wanted to add that as well, the idea of competitors. I think when you talk about the competitive landscape, I think that is will make the CMO and CEO and founders' ears perk up. They want to know what they're doing and they're always looking around them and how are they doing it better. So if you can say, oh, hey, you're concerned about A, B, and C, well, look what they're doing to get this coverage. Look what's working for them or what's not working. And I think that's a really great way to get their attention is by showcasing what the competitor is doing or jumping in on the holes that maybe the competitors are also missing.
Mm-hmm. My only caution with this, with the competitor side, is you might look at, let's say, five of these competitors and you go, okay, all of their content is really self-serving. They're doing exactly what we're doing. We're all doing the same thing. And so, again, do your research to see, because the counter argument to, oh my gosh, everyone's just basically doing the same thing can easily be, and that is why we need to do something different. That's exactly why we got to do something different, because we're just being lost in the whole mix right now. And we don't want to be like that. And we're definitely not going to get stories for that.
Exactly. Let's use it as here's the benchmark and we can do better because they're just doing, the same old and they're not being successful. So let's use this as an opportunity where no one's covering anyone in our space because we're all doing it wrong. So let's be the ones to do it right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Nicole, we have solved all the problems this week. Just these. There's always more. That's why we'll be back next week with even more. But thank you so much, Nicole, for hopping on here. I know how busy you are. I really appreciate it. And we all appreciate it to get your BAMfness into our wonderful podcast.
Of course, it was a pleasure. And I love listening to the content. I'm learning from your other guests as well. So it's a great opportunity. Thank you.
Thanks for listening to Dear BAMf, the advice podcast for PR and marketing pros like you. Our show is created by BAM, a PR and marketing agency headquartered in San Diego and New York City. The music you're enjoying today was composed by Tiffany Dizon, produced by Daniel Kessner, and played by San Diego Symphony's Art of Alon. Thank you to our podcast production team at Citizen Recording. If you have a tough PR and marketing question you'd like us to answer, please write to us at bamtheagency.com/Dear BAMf. Don't forget the F. We'll be back next Monday with another episode of Dear BAMf. Until then.